Great to see everybody. I did see some grown-ups during the communion doing the lost sheep maze. Thank you, Chris, for sharing those scriptures from the book of Ephesians. And we are going to be back in the book of Ephesians in chapter 5 as we continue this series. Really, overall, on God's grace, and on these particular chapters, on the life of holiness. Let's read together in Ephesians chapter 5, in verse 1. Ephesians chapter 5, in verse 1. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Therefore, be imitators of God. Now, in just a couple of passages here, you see how much the emphasis is on love. And that's really the topic for today's sermon, and that thought, the life of holiness is a life of love. Living in love, as this passage directs us. But before we really get into breaking down this passage and applying it, I think as we read this, it really begs the question, what is love? What is love? We use love to describe all kinds of things, right? Who in here loves pizza?
Yeah.
We love pizza, don't we? We also love vacations to the beach, right? We love kittens. We love our children. We love when the boys score a goal, right? There's all kinds of things that we really love, that we use the word love to describe. We have the Beatles to remind us that all we need is love. Every year or so, we have a Disney movie that teaches us a story about love, right? Thank you, Ariel and Prince Eric. And on top of that, we have a holiday that reminds us about love, Valentine's Day. The balloons, the flowers, the chocolate. But what is it really? Because if you think about it, for as much as we use the language of love to describe things, as much as we find it in our media, in our music, and as much as we talk about it in our culture, we do seem to be a little bit confused, don't we? Is loving pizza really the same thing as loving our children?
No.
Is it? Some of us aren't sure. Hopefully it's not. Hopefully we mean different things when we say, I love pizza and I love my kids. Is love really as simple as the plot in a Disney movie? Like what we see in The Little Mermaid or Beauty and the Beast? Is it a feeling within us? Or is it something that we go out and search for? People talk about searching for love, trying to find love. Or is it really as simple as the balloons and the chocolate on Valentine's Day? What is love? You know, in the Greek language, there were several words that ended up getting translated as love. Oh, you see the last one right there. But I want to go through a couple of these because these different words all have a different sense. The word eros is a Greek word, and what that referred to was sexual desire or attraction. That's the love we talk about when we talk about something romantically charged, and there's a passion involved. The word phileo is sometimes translated as love in the New Testament, and that refers to a mutual affection. Sometimes it's called brotherly love. And what that is it's the kind of responsive back and forth kindness and devotion that we see amongst close friends, maybe family members. It's the love of two people really being there for each other, and it tends to develop over time. Storge is a term translated as love, but that refers to a natural affection. It's the feeling of fondness that sort of emanates instinctively from within. You don't have to generate it. Really, it's just there. It's the love that you have for a pet, or it's the love that you have for a parent, or for a family member. But then, there is agape. Agape is sacrificial love. And this is the love that is shown when you value something for itself, or you do good for someone for their own sake. Even if it is one way, even if there's no return or response. And it's something that is deliberate, it's something that's choice-based. And so you see, it differs from these other words. It differs from eros, and it differs from storge, because those are more feelings-oriented, where you see agape is something that is deliberate. Agape comes from a choice that we make, and not necessarily just a feeling. And it's different from phileo, because in phileo, there's a back and forth. There's an I'm there for you and you're there for me, and that's the kind of love and relationship that we have. But agape is actually one way. Agape is love that is given and is continued to be given even if there isn't a return or a response. Agape is the word that's used throughout this passage in Ephesians chapter 5. This is the kind of love that is talked about in the scriptures. And interestingly enough, according to one scholarly research of Greek literature, not just the Bible, but Greek literature outside of the Bible, but contemporary to the time of the New Testament, the use of agape and the topic of agape is actually very sparse in Greek literature, contemporary Greek literature outside of the New Testament. It's rare to just find a word or find discussions about it. It's not found very often. But in the New Testament, it's used abundantly, about 320 times in the New Testament, in various forms, agape is discussed. That tells us something about how important and how central agape love is to Christianity. Indeed, it is the central point. You know, if you want to boil all of Christianity down into a sentence or two, if you wanted my vote for a passage that boils Christianity down to a sentence or two, this would probably be my vote. This would be it. It really captures the essence of the Christian life. But it's important to again understand that to really get it, to understand that love, what kind of love is being talked about there when it says to be an imitator of God and to live in love. It's talking about that agape, that sacrificial kind of love. You know, we talked last week about holiness and about dealing with sin and the truth. The thought that we left off on last week was this, that when we are no longer burdened by anger, shame, or hurt in our relationships, then we're free to focus on growth and change and holiness. Because in a holy relationship with God, when we deal with sin and experience true forgiveness, it ushers us into this new place, into a new relationship, and that relationship, again, this passage is connected with the previous one, that's why it says therefore, right? Because of that, then we enter into this life, we enter into this transformative relationship with God, where we become like Him, and we grow into beings that live lives of agape. You know, it says as dearly loved children. Boy, that's a powerful thought right there. And a powerful phrase, isn't it? This reminds us of the unique context and setting of our relationship with God. It's special. It's holy, right? That's what the word holy means, something special, something different. And the relationship that we have with God is special. It's like a dearly loved child. That's who we are with God. And that's how God is with us. And I appreciate the emphasis of that description, dearly loved. We do begin estranged and alienated from God. You know, He does love us dearly, but it's at a distance. Last week, I also talked a little bit, shared from my personal life about how I restored this relationship with my parents and with my father in particular around the time that I got baptized. And I was dealing with sin and I was seeking forgiveness. And there were things about my life, the way that I was living, deceitfulness and all kinds of things that I had to get open about and come into the light with my father. And I feared that discussion because I feared the consequences. I feared what might come from it. I feared just being ashamed before Him. But it was so powerful to see how He treated me with mercy and grace in that relationship. And for me, it was like a little picture of God, how God treats us. And I felt like a dearly loved child. And even though I knew, you know, my dad, he always loved me. He always wanted the best for me. But we were estranged because of me. We were alienated because of the darkness and the deceitfulness in my life. And that's so much like our relationships with God. He never doesn't love us. He can't love us more and he can't love us less. But the issue is, are we living as his dearly loved children? Or are we estranged? Are we alienated from him? But once we restore that relationship with him, we then become imitators of God. That's a powerful thing, isn't it? You ever notice that we end up imitating and following the example of our parents, whether we like it or not? Have you seen that yourself? I know I have. You know, Karen and I get a kick out of it. We're very close to both sides of our families. Our in-laws get along well, which is a great blessing, right? But over the years, how, you know, I see Kara with her mom, and I kind of see more and more, oh, that's where it comes from. And Kara kind of hangs out with me and my dad, and she'll, like, comment afterwards about, you know, that look on your face, I see it on your dad, too. I see where you get it from.
No, I can't.
It's interesting, my kids are growing up, seeing them, you know, seeing myself in them, right? Seeing their tendencies. We end up imitating their parents, or imitating our parents, but a child who is dearly loved by their parent, and knows it, and feels it, they strive to imitate their parents. They don't just end up that way naturally, but they love to admire their parents. Children who are dearly loved. When we really identify with God as our Father, and we're able to identify ourselves as his dearly loved children, and it opens up that great, incredible dynamic with him, we should strive to be like him. But is that who we really identify with God as our Father, and us as dearly loved children? Because when we make that connection, we are in a posture to really get and understand love and then live it out ourselves. You know, this passage talks about loving just as Christ also loved us. And it's really awesome how when Jesus Christ came into the world, God in the flesh, he was really helping us out. Because I think he saw in the world that, you know, there's a lot of confusion in the world about what love really is. And I can speak about it through law, and I can speak about it through revelation. But the amazing thing about Jesus is that was God packaging a human body. And what he did is he just came down and said, I'm just going to show them once and for all what love is really like, what agape is really like as a human being. So that way we would know what to imitate, who to imitate, and how to do it. What was Christ's agape really like? Well, let me put it into a little bit of a perspective here. I want you to consider for a moment the following real story of heroism. This is something that happened just this past week in Scotland, and I'm reading from a newspaper here. Rescuers who battled to pull a trapped woman from her burning vehicle were almost driven back by the intense heat. Brian Brown was one of the motorists who stopped at the scene of the head-on accident near Guildtown on Monday and rushed to help. The badly damaged vehicles had ended up in a ditch at the side of the A93 and were beginning to smolder, with the woman and child still inside. Quote, there were already two lads helping and they had got the wee girl out. We tried to get the lady out. I was trying to pull her out from the front side window, but her leg was trapped. The car was already smoldering. I was quite sure it was going to ignite any minute. It was getting closer and closer. The flame started. It was an inferno, Mr. Brown said. It was so frantic. I thought it was going to blow up in flames. It was just horrendous. It was a nightmare. It was the other two brave chaps who must have pulled her out. It emerged that two of the other heroes were from a haulage and parcel company in Midlothian. One of them, Stephen Mitchell, said on social media that getting the woman free before the flames engulfed the car was, quote, a miracle. At the scene of the accident, Perth Station Commander Bob Rearney of Scottish Fire and Rescue Service praised those who stopped. Quote, The occupants of the car were extremely lucky. If it wasn't for the bravery of the passers-by, it would have been a very different story, he said. Inspector Ian Martin of Trunk Roads Policing North said, quote, "It is always amazing how willing the public are to step up and assist people in their time of need with their selfless actions. I know it is the intention of police to stop me to ensure that the actions demonstrated by those yesterday are rightly acknowledged." So Brian Brown and Steve Mitchell and this other fellow who helped out, they're being praised as heroes, aren't they? And what they did is something rare and something special, isn't it? To run into a dangerous situation and potentially risk yourself to help a stranger. It's not an everyday kind of occurrence, is it? It's rare. I mean, if it was an everyday kind of occurrence, there wouldn't be news articles about it, right? We would just see it happen every day, but we don't. And so when it does happen, it gets praise and recognition. Well, let me change a couple of things about this story to consider this. How much more special would this story be if the following things changed? What if Brian Brown and Steve Mitchell, the guys being mentioned here, what if they did know the motorist in that car? And what if the motorist in that car was someone who was a sworn enemy of theirs? That motorist spent her life, her time, her energy, and her effort just undermining Brian Brown and Stephen Mitchell's lives and purpose. And what if instead of Brown and Mitchell potentially risking their life, they actually went into a flaming car knowing that they would die, but would give the woman, a known enemy, a chance to be saved? How often do you hear accounts like that happening? Have you ever heard that happen? But that's precisely how Jesus Christ loved us. You see, at just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die, right? That's Paul acknowledging that these acts of selfless heroism, giving their lives, are very rare. They may happen sometimes, every now and then, but only when, for people that we think are sort of righteous and godly. But God demonstrates his own agape, his love for us in this, while we were still sinners, while we were still enemies of God, while we were undermining the purpose of Jesus Christ. Christ died for us. That is agape. See, agape is love that goes on the offensive. It's a choice to find and seek out people to serve, encourage, and sacrifice for, including and perhaps particularly those who may be enemies towards you. Agape is not passive. Agape doesn't wait to ask to be roused into action. Agape doesn't wait for volunteers, right? Someone to ask for volunteers. It's not reactive. Agape doesn't wait to be given to first before it gives. It doesn't wait to be recognized or appreciated before going into action. It makes the first deliberate decision to get off the couch and find a way to be there for someone else first. And if it doesn't yield an immediate return, or even any return, it does not matter to agape. And it doesn't stop or prevent agape from being first in line the next time around to give. And therein lies the blessing and, I think, the challenge for us. The blessing is realizing that this is God's posture toward us. We are dearly loved children. And that's how God loves us, in that way, in that fashion, loving us first, giving to us first, whether we appreciate it or not. But yet, the blessing is also the challenge, because then the challenge is us being called to live lives that way as well. None of us are living lives of 100% agape. None of us. That's the constant ideal for us to have in our lives to grow into, as part of this holy life. Are you growing toward a life of greater and greater agape? Is that the track of things? And you know, this question is particularly tough, I think, for those of us who've been Christians for a long time. This question gets harder to answer the longer that we are Christians. Because the longer we're Christians, the more we develop a track record of giving and serving and sacrificing, don't we? And it can get easier and easier and easier to sort of look back on that track record as opposed to continue looking forward to the example of Christ. And it can be easy to say, I've given so much, and I've sacrificed so much, and I've put myself out there so much. Isn't it somebody else's turn to step up, right? And of course, yes, it's someone else's turn to step up. It's always someone else's turn to step up because everyone is supposed to be living in a God way, right? But that doesn't excuse us from living out our own Christ-like agape. Those are two independent points, right? The standard is to love like Christ. When did Jesus ever say enough? When did Jesus ever say, I'm at my limit? It's an upward call. But the amazing thing is that we can grasp this. That's the amazing thing. Because we think about the standard, we think about ourselves, and it's lofty, and we can get discouraged, but this is the promise of the scriptures and the promise of this passage, that we can grow to be imitators of God. But we can only do it as part of a holy life and a special relationship with Christ. Agape is a way of life that does not come naturally to us. It is counterintuitive to the selfish instincts we have in the world. The me-first thinking, the social Darwinistic thinking, the survival of the fittest, the survival of the strong, to take care of me first, it runs against that grain. Living in agape, a lifestyle of agape, requires transformation and a holy lifestyle that we only get in a relationship with God through Christ where we experience agape from Him. So as we close out with prayer, and as we go to our fellowship with our coffee and our tea and our biscuits, let's have this thought on our mind. Am I really living out and growing towards agape? We can have some good discussion in our fellowship time about that. So we'll say a prayer and then we'll be dismissed. You can go get the children from children's ministry. Enjoy the time of fellowship. Let's pray. Father in heaven, it's amazing. When we sit back and we think about the height and the depths and just the dimensions of Christ's love for us, we're so grateful that He came into the world. We're so grateful that He loved us the way that He did. And we're also grateful yet challenged by the fact that what He did was not just something for us to benefit from, but also something for us to strive to imitate. Help us to know that we are dearly loved children. Help us to have a heart and a deep desire in our souls to imitate You. Empower us as we look to Jesus Christ, as we continue to be part of a holy relationship with You through Him, that we continue to grow and grow and change, always looking forward, never looking backwards, towards agape, living a life of love, just as Your Son did. We love You, thank You, it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. At this time, we can be dismissed.